Now, Dennis was one of the very few people who could sometimes actually tell her what to do. I mean, there are stories of her speaking to a cabinet minister and giving him what for down the phone, and Dennis would suddenly look up from his paper and say, "Margaret, that's enough of him." And she would say, "Well, I've got to go now," and meekly put the phone down. She could sometimes be quite biddable.
He would say, I mean, I've been at dinners when she says, "Margaret, it's time we left. You know, we've got to get you back." And she'd go. She had a lot of respect for Dennis. She really appreciated his common sense and his down to earth and the fact that he'd say whatever was in his mind. And she really treasured that. He was a great support to her at a difficult time. But he was very proud of her too. But she did set a lot of store by number 10. Not as a personal sort of thing, but as the home of the Prime Minister and a place that people should come to and admire.
Now, at the very end, you came back here to resign. You resigned at the same time as she did. Do you have any memories of that last time coming up the staircase here?
Yes, I do remember. I'd decided that I didn't want to work with John Major and John Major's government. I felt the cabinet had really let her down, and I just didn't want to be involved. So on the Monday, that the final vote was on the Tuesday, I came here to say to her, "Look, you appointed me. I would like to resign to you and leave with you." I came in here, and so an appointment was made. And I came in, and it was the most eerie experience, because every corridor and all the staircases were lined with flowers. There were literally thousands of bouquets and flowers, and they went right up the stairs, right to the door of the study. And I went in there, and she was sitting behind the desk with four or five papers to sign. And there was the most... I'd been in a similar situation before, but you had the feeling that all power had gone. You know, this the most powerful person in the land, one of the most, until a few hours earlier. Now power had been stripped away. And the only other time I experienced that was when Ted Heath, in 74, he came into the whip's office when he'd called the election. I was a whip then, and we had a drink, and we drank champagne. And then he came a few days later when we'd lost, after the election, and he'd been trying to put a coalition together. He came back into the whip's office, the opposition, and all the power had gone from him, all the authority. And it was exactly the same feeling in number 10 that night. I just felt, you know, this really is the end of the road. And it made me very angry, because in my opinion, it was also unnecessary, but I know there are other views about that.
End of a great era.
End of a remarkable era. I mean, just, you know, I remember going to Russia in 79 and being told we were the sick man of Europe. They didn't want to buy anything from us. We were hopeless. All our stuff was useless. We were always late. Going back 10 years later, when the Politburo were fighting for the opportunity to have a meeting with me. I mean, because Britain was seen as a country that had transformed itself. So it was very sad that it ended the way it did, but that's it.